Erlend, welcome. Thanks for joining us in the AWS studio.
Thank you very much. Happy to be here.
Want to tell us a little bit more about your role at Working Group 2?
I am CEO of Working Group 2. So yeah, lead the company on a daily basis and part of the founding team as well.
I think the origin story for Working Group 2 is fascinating. Tell us a little bit about how your company got its start.
Yeah, so it's a long story. It started as almost like a skunkworks project inside of Telenor Group, which is one of the big mobile operators in the world. It was partly a technical project, and then I got involved in it after having worked in Asia. And I had a very specific experience in Asia, where I was working with the Googles and the Facebooks of the world. And while I was inside Telenor, and the experience from that was every time we had a meeting, the Googles and the Facebooks, they brought an engineer, they brought a product manager, and they had built something, they had fixed something for the next meeting. And we as an operator tended to maybe have written a specification that maybe our procurement department had maybe talked with the supplier with. And there was a very tangible difference in speed of innovation. And I think over time that accumulates to that the industry is going to be very challenged. That frustrated me. I met my co-founder, Werner Eriksson, who's the CTO. He was building what was then called software telco, which is basically a software is eating the world version of a mobile core network. We spun that out of Telenor into a separate company, and for the last 5 years, we've been building mobile core as a global programmable platform.
So let's dive a little bit deeper into the evolution of mobile core as a service. We were talking earlier about this idea of transformation pressures for telcos. Help me understand that better in the context of mobile cores and what you were seeing from customers.
I think core is the most underutilized, the most ignored, and part of a mobile network. It's not your biggest cost. You know, radio networks are always going to be the biggest cost for mobile operators. But core, in a way, is where the magic happens. It's where you go from bits and bytes into services. And I think what's happened over the last 3 or 4 decades is the industry has focused on cost. And the way to drive down cost in core has been to make every box by any vendor replaceable with any other box from any other vendor. And what this has led to is massive complexity, because you have typically many, many different vendors in your network. Every box has to work with every other box in the world. So the boxes themselves become incredibly complex, and then you have many boxes, and that complexity becomes overwhelming. And then in addition, you have 2G, you have 3G, you have 4G, now you have 5G. You had CS voice, you have IMS, you have SMS over this generation, SMS over that. The complexity becomes overwhelming. So core has become a bottleneck. It's become a cost item. I haven't almost heard from any operator that loves their core. Everybody sees it as a pain point and as a cost item, as an inhibitor to innovation. It's a broken core networks. It's almost like a broken industry, and it needs to be fixed because it's actually a source of innovation and product development and value creation. But that's not what it is today. So that's what we're on a mission to change, and I think we're seeing that that's possible to do.
So building on your mission, do you think that the cloud can help operators fall in love again with the mobile core?
I think absolutely. I think the cloud enables a couple of things. Enables small teams to do very big things. And that's where our cloud journey started. We started actually using OpenStack, and we found that we're spending half our team's time managing hardware and virtualization platforms, and we shifted to AWS 7 years ago now. So we've been sitting on AWS for 7 years building a cloud-native core. So it allowed a very small team to do very big things. I think that's the first thing that cloud does. The second thing is it's like standing on the shoulder of giants, right? You have some really spectacular security services, you have managed databases, you have any number of things that we would have to stand up big separate teams to do. And relying on that allows us to become very professional and be very secure and have a lot of flexibility that would otherwise take hundreds of people to do. The third thing it does is that it allows you to do things at global scale. So in the scheme of the industry, we're a fairly small company, but we're actually live across the globe, and we're spinning up in different regions. And, you know, and we're now spinning up in a new region. We have terraformed all our infrastructure, and in days, we have new cores up and standing. And that global consistency suddenly allows you to do one thing at global scale, which was very, very hard to do previously. Those are just some of the things that we really deeply leverage cloud and AWS.
So I want to dive a little deeper into your cloud transformation journey with AWS. What was your experience? You mentioned a lot of the services and partner solutions, the likes of Terraform. What's been your experience on AWS? There are specific services that have made your journey remarkably effective or cost effective, scalable?
Any number of them. So there's a large number of them that we use. I think things like guard duty. Trying to replicate guard duty at small scale, I think is, if not impossible, you're going to have a very, very big team to do it. Things like managed Kafka, managed RDS, you can do them on your own, but then suddenly you have a team that has to do that, which has an, you know, a big alternative cost for us. And I think if I we have kind of a list of the services that we use, and it's extensive. But a lot of it is around we can move faster, we can offload the team so that they can focus on where we can create value, as opposed to managing not basic stuff, but stuff that we don't really want to focus on. We can focus on the application, and we can use a managed database, for example. If we had to have three people building a managed database, that has a very high cost for us. So it's speed, it's flexibility. And then these services are good. They work really well, right? And we often, resiliency is a huge thing for us running core networks. So getting managed services that automatically work across regions, that have inbuilt resiliency and redundancy, that's powerful for us.
So through the speed and agility, you can start to develop your own value-added services. We talked a little bit about beyond the mobile core, opportunities in IoT and mobile private networks. Tell me a little bit more about your solution suite.
So we have a kind of a fundamental philosophy about this, and then there's a resulting large set of use cases. So in a way, I think we're inspired by AWS in this regard. So, you know, if you're leveraging S3 or EC2, the smallest startup in the world can go in with a credit card and use S3. Citibank, you know, one of the biggest companies in the world, will use the same S3 API. And the same for EC2 and the same for almost every other AWS service. Now, the use case they use it for, you don't know about it, actually. You know, that they can use it for lots of different things. We're building the mobile core with the same mindset. So we think that if it's a private network for 10 SIMs, or if it's an MNO network for 10 million SIMs, a lot of the technology is actually the same. The security should be the same. The scale, of course, is different. And the complexity of services can be slightly different. If it's a, you know, data-only private network and if it's a full MNO core, they are different. But actually, you know, your user databases are the same, your packet gateways are the same, et cetera, et cetera. So we're building this with the mindset of a hyperscaler, that we're building common infrastructure where you can choose both the scale at which you want to do things and the depth of the services that you want to use. Out of that comes everything from private networks, hybrid private and public networks, IoT networks, MVNOs, MVNEs, MVNAs, NEMNX, and MNOs. Because the basic functional technology is actually the same at the heart of the service, it just has different incarnations. And in our model, we have a multi-tenant model, which allows an operator to actually even have what will be perceived as different networks for different use cases. And they can attach different management systems and different applications on top of those networks.
I like how you mentioned that different incarnations based on the same underlying modular, scalable infrastructure. Maybe we dive a little bit deeper into one of the use cases. Is there a disaster recovery as a service play here?
Yeah, so we think that's one of the really interesting ones that we're looking quite closely into now, which is, I think the only thing that you can be sure about networks is that at some point they're going to fail, unfortunately. And both for ourselves and our customers, we think disaster recovery is a particularly interesting one, partly because of the economic equation. Having an empty network sitting somewhere idle is a very expensive piece of kit. But using cloud, you know, you can have as part of a broader platform, you can actually very economically have a disaster recovery. That's one aspect of it. It can be a very, it's almost like a cheap insurance policy that you can have standing. The second part of it is, like we do now, we operate out of three different regions, and we have, in one of our regions, we have a fourth region as a disaster recovery zone. We can actually spin up in, you know, is it 23 different regions Amazon has now? Something like that. We could actually realistically spin up in any region within hours. And we can also do hot standby between regions. So I think the resiliency and the disaster recovery part of the story is very interesting. It's still early days for the product as such, but it's a very interesting story to do.
Maybe let's fast forward for a second as we look towards the future of mobile core as a service. What's the next level of working group two on AWS? What does that look like?
The current status in the world is every operator in the world basically deploy their own core in their own specific way. So you have, you know, a few hundred operators in the world, and you have an equal amount of incarnations of different cores. Now, each of these operators might be big in their own country, but they're actually very subscale in the context of big tech. And it's very inefficient, this way of doing it, and it inhibits innovation very powerfully. So we think that building this as platforms, as global cores, is actually going to change things radically. So we think 10 years from now, or give or take a few years, we think you're going to see an evolution to global mobile core platforms to which operators attach their radio networks, changing the whole model, really, where you have a platform that is there, and you simply attach your radio network, and you get all the benefits of that platform constantly. That's the first part of it. The second part of it is, if you build it that way, you can realistically start making these networks programmable. You start exposing APIs, and you start building what we used to call Android for networks. You basically build app stores for networks. And any developer in the world can today come onto our platform, build their product, publish their product, and any operator on the platform in a completely different country can actually activate that product. So this business model of platforms reducing the cost of innovation very close to zero, we think that's the future of mobile core networks.
So for enterprises and operators looking to learn more about Working Group 2, where should they turn to?
Yeah, they can, of course, reach out to us directly. They can go to our website. I think that's a good place to start. So they can reach us there in a contact form, and we'll be in touch very shortly.
Wonderful. It's a great discussion here today, Erlend. Thanks for joining the AWS studio, and really appreciate your thoughts and insights.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.